of war-torn Sudan.
The Philippine Justice Department wants more suspects in the killing of Provincial Governor Roel Degamo tagged as terrorists.
And Australia eyes a major military buildup to address China's dominance in the Asia-Pacific region.
Good evening, I'm Tony Velasquez.
And I'm Pia Gutierrez.
On our broadcast tonight, desperate calls for help by Filipinos caught in the bloody military feud in Sudan. The Philippine Foreign Affairs Department denies it has neglected to organize a rescue plan for them. Zana Hernandez has tonight's top story.
The Sudanese capital of Khartoum has turned into a battleground between military factions fighting for control. According to James Glorioso, overseas Filipino worker in Khartoum, there are no more safe areas left in the city, as looting has also become rampant in the midst of the chaos and bombardment. They have been appealing for rescue from the Philippine government since April 16, a day after the fighting broke out, but were only asked to submit documents so far. Most telecommunication networks are already down, and they worry about communication becoming an issue by the time rescue comes. But the Department of Foreign Affairs gave the assurance help is on its way.
From Khartoum, dadaling sila by bus to the border town between Sudan and Egypt, and from there, dadaling sa Aswan, which is a tourist town in Egypt. May flights doon. So, this week, possibly within the next 24 hours, meron na tayong umpisang marirepatriate. Unti-unti, nag-aagawan kasi tayo with other countries, competition for the available bus. And hindi basta-basta magsasakay, kailangan may escort o may tao from the consulate.
Land travel to the Egyptian border will take at least 15 hours. Filipinos will be evacuated by batches, but incomplete travel documents may prove to be a challenge. The Philippine Embassy in Cairo, Egypt, which has jurisdiction in Sudan, is organizing the repatriation. From an initial list of over 250 Filipinos, the embassy now has almost 700 Filipinos in its registry. From this number, half are expected to seek repatriation, while the rest are expected to evacuate with employers. The DFA committed to assist all Filipino nationals, including undocumented OFWs. One of them is Noemi Sanchez, a victim of human trafficking.
Parang hindi po inasikaso yung mga Pilipino dito. Pati po yung consul dito, hindi po kumikilos. Kami na lang po mga Pilipino na nandito sa Khartoum. Sobra na nga po ang takot namin dahil sunod-sunod na po ang putukan dito. Umaga pa lang po hanggang hapon.
Various reports state that over 400 have been killed in the fighting in Sudan, increasing fears of a full-blown civil war and humanitarian crisis. The Foreign Affairs Department has already recommended raising the alert level status to 3, which translates to voluntary evacuation. Zen Hernandez, ABS-CBN News.
Various countries race to extract their citizens from Sudan. France and Germany on Monday said they evacuated around 700 people but did not give a breakdown of their nationalities. Several countries also sent military planes to fly people out of the Sudanese capital. Other operations took people by convoy to Port Sudan on the Red Sea. From there, some have boarded ships bound for Saudi Arabia.
It has been a complex operation and it has been a successful operation. First, the staff of the European Union, 21 people are already in Europe, and many more European Union citizens and others are already out of Sudan. I cannot give you the concrete figure, more than 1,000 people for sure. I want to thank France especially for taking our people out. And I want to thank the combined efforts of many countries that took their nationals, but also all nationals that they could pick.
China, Denmark, Lebanon, the Netherlands, Switzerland, and Sweden said they have extracted their citizens. Japan is preparing to send an evacuation team to Khartoum.
Philippine President Marcos Jr. says he's confident the new national police chief he appointed can handle the numerous controversies hounding the police force. This report from Pia Gugelis.
President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. has named Police General Benjamin Acorda Jr. as the 29th Chief of the Philippine National Police, replacing Police General Rodolfo Azorin Jr., who formally retired Monday. Acorda, who hails from Ilocos Norte, is a member of the PMA's Ambisig class of 1991. Prior to his appointment as the country's top cop, he served as the PNP Director for Intelligence, as well as Regional Director for PNP Northern Mindanao, Regional Chief of the CIDG 4B, and Deputy Director for Operations and Deputy Director for Administration of the NCRPO. As PNP Chief, Acorda is set to lead the 228,000-strong police force, which is currently beset by a number of controversies, including the alleged involvement of police officials in the drug trade, as well as the supposed cover-up of last year's drug buy bust involving over 6 billion pesos worth of illegal drugs. In an interview, President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. says he chose Acorda because he believes Acorda will be able to calm the situation at the PNP.
Dahil marami nga tayong pinapalitan, marami meron tayong ginagawang housing, meron tayong inaayos natin yung pension, tinitignan natin, inimbisigahan natin kung sino yung mga involved sa sindikato ng droga. Lahat yan ay sabay-sabay natin ginawa dahil kailangan na talagang ayusin. At kaya sa paakin palagi, very steady naman ito ang ating bagong PMP chief. Kaya makakalma niya yan hanggat matapos ang trabaho.
Among the president's marching orders to Acorda are to protect the weak and vulnerable, to serve with integrity and accountability, and to always be open to public scrutiny.
Make your presence felt in the streets. Make them safer. Defend our democratic institutions, our cherished ideals. Protect the people, especially the weak, the vulnerable, and those who indirectly work with us in the same cause, such as journalists, civic action groups, civil volunteers, the like. Finally, serve the people with integrity, with accountability, and genuine justice. Always be open to public scrutiny and practice restraint and maximum tolerance in the face of harsh criticism.
In his inaugural speech, the new PNP chief issued a dire warning to policemen involved in the illegal drug trade.
My stand on anti-illegal drugs is clear. No police should be involved in pushing, using, or whatever means of illegal drug trade. You will be charged and removed from the service. This is my warning to each and every one of you. Our fight will be holistic in prevention and aggressive in operations.
Retired PNP Chief Azorin meanwhile expressed hope the PNP leadership will be cleared from allegations of wrongdoing and that those involved in the proliferation of drugs will be soon brought to justice.
The PNP is now under scrutiny, but I trust our Lord and our people that justice will be on our side once we have brought to justice those involved in the proliferation of drugs in our country. In a few days, more reports will come out, and I hope my successor will be able to continue what we started and pursue this cause.
The president meanwhile thanked Azorin, under whose leadership he says the PNP made substantial accomplishments in the area of peace and order, particularly in the campaigns against terrorism, carjacking, loose firearms, child abuse, gambling, and smuggling. He also urged the former chief and other retirees of the PNP to continue supporting the government's fight against criminality.
The Philippine Justice Secretary wants more suspects in the murder of Provincial Governor Roel Digamo included in the government's terror watch list. This new pronouncement as Digamo's widow faced the suspects for the first time since her husband's assassination. Adrian Ayalin reports.
The emotional toll was too heavy for Pamplona Negros Oriental Mayor Janice Degamo when she saw for the first time the four suspects in the killing of her husband, Governor Roel Degamo. Mayor Degamo was with her lawyer, Attorney Levito Baligod, during the preliminary investigation on the killing of Degamo and eight others last March 4.
Wala akong word dun. Wala. Wala. Mahirap i-describe.
Mahagulgul kanina siya. Umiiyak siya kanina during the proceedings. Dahil siyempre, naaalala niya yung nangyari, namatayan siya ng asawa. At yun, nakita naman niya na ayaw nang mag-file ng counter affidavits yung mga respondents dahil technically ay inaamin naman nila na involved sila doon sa nangyaring patayan.
Mayor Degamo believes cases against suspended Negros Oriental 3rd District Representative Arnulfo Teves may be filed soon. Teves has been described as the killing's mastermind by Justice Secretary Boying Remulla.
We're almost there. Hintay na lang tayo for resolution na yung dito po. So, antabayan na lang natin.
Remulla, meanwhile, again asked for patience amid criticisms that no cases have been filed against Teves and no arrest warrant has been issued so far. Remulla claimed a chopper owned by Teves, which was used to transport the fleeing suspects from Negros Oriental to Maguindanao, may further pin down the lawmaker.
Yan, isa yan sa mga bagay na mapapaniwala ka na meron siyang kinalaman. Kasi chopper niya mismo ang ginamit na sinakyan ng mga salarin upang makataka sila mula sa Negros Oriental kasi naka-checkpoint na lahat eh.
Remulla added he will be meeting with the Anti-Terror Council soon as he insisted there's basis to tag Teves as a terrorist given his links to illegal gambling.
The fact that this money is being used, was used to finance terrorism, should be one angle that we should follow as investigators, as people who were investigating a crime so dastardly.
Remulla believes that aside from Teves, other individuals may also be tagged in the supposed terrorist organization.
They played very pivotal roles in the plots that ensued in what happened to Governor Degamo. Remember, Governor Degamo was a governor of a province, the highest locally elected official in the country. And for that to be done to him took a lot of gumption. And that act alone instilled fear in most people in Negros Oriental.
As for comment, the lawyer of Teves, Attorney Ferdinand Topacio, refused to make a statement. Another preliminary investigation on the illegal possession of firearms complaint against Teves and his sons Kurt and Axel was also held at the DOJ.
Nag-submit po ng dagdag na dokumento ang CIDG katulad po yung mga hiningi sa kanila noong nakaraan. Ibinigay lang po sa amin ngayon at binibigyan kami ng pagkakataon na pag-aralan, repasuhin, timbangin kung ano ang dapat o nararapat naming ipasa sa panel sa susunod na hearing.
Adrian Ayalin, ABS-CBN News.
The daily average of COVID-19 cases in the Philippines climbs by more than 30%. The uptick of infections prompts transport authorities to remind commuters of the mandatory use of face masks in public vehicles. This story from Willard Chang.
The Department of Health reported a 32% increase in the average number of daily COVID-19 cases from April 17 to 23, from 341 in the previous week to 450. 3,148 new cases were reported compared to 2,386 the previous week. ICU bed utilization was also up from 12.3% to 13.7%. Given the numbers, the DOH reminds the public not to take COVID-19 for granted and to follow minimum public health standards such as wearing of face masks, staying in well-ventilated places, and availing of COVID-19 vaccines and booster shots. 26 provinces remain under Alert Level 2 status from April 15 up to the end of the month, except for their component cities and municipalities that remain under Alert Level 1, according to the latest resolution of the Interagency Task Force for the Management of Emerging Infectious Diseases. Areas under Alert Level 2 are allowed a maximum of 50% indoor capacity, and 70% outdoor venue capacity. Metro Manila and other areas remain under Alert Level 1, where full on-site or venue and seating capacity is allowed following minimum public health standards. The Department of Health clarifies the 26 areas under Alert Level 2 have maintained their status since June of last year. While these areas have low-risk classification for cases and utilization rates, they have vaccination rates lower than 70% of the target total population or 70% of the total senior citizen population. Meeting the targets, the DOH says, will allow these areas to be placed under Alert Level 1. The DOH points out, no province or city has been escalated to Alert Level 2 since the start of 2023. The DOH says, while some hospitals have reported some increase in admission, none has reported reaching full capacity. There is also no change in the health department's isolation or quarantine protocol. Meanwhile, the Department of Transportation reminds commuters, wearing of face masks remains mandatory in public transportation, including MRT, LRT, and PNR trains. Marshals in train stations are ready to remind commuters to abide by health precautions. Talking and use of cell phones for calls inside the train are not allowed as well.
Dikit-dikit ang mga tao, mas malaki din yung risk na kumalat yung COVID, no, kahit naka-mask. Kasi hindi naman yung mask naman hindi siya foolproof, 'di ba? So, yun yung iniiwasan doon.
Drivers and passengers of bus, jeepneys, and taxis are also required to wear face masks.
Mga pasahero natin na makita nyo na nagbabiolate, they can take a picture and send it to LTFRB para po ma-action na po ng LTFRB. Lalo na yung driver kasi sila yung may liability sa loob ng public utility vehicle.
Wearing of face masks in airports remains optional, but not inside the plane where masking up is still required. Willard Cheng, ABS-CBN News.
Next in the news, China's foreign ministry contradicts its ambassador to France and affirms the sovereignty of ex-Soviet states.
The World Tonight returns after a short break.
We're back on The World Tonight. Philippine President Marcos Jr. says it's time for Manila to update its security deals with Washington. He points to growing tensions in the Asia-Pacific region that may already require this. The president made the remarks during an interview Monday on the radio program of his former Social Welfare Secretary, Erwin Tulfo. He says he will discuss Philippine-American defense agreements when he meets U.S. President Biden in Washington next week. Marcos Jr. says he and Biden may tackle the U.S.-Philippines Mutual Defense Agreement and the Visiting Forces Agreement, which Manila renewed with Washington in 2021.
It has to evolve. Dahil nag-evolve din, ina-adjust din natin yan. Dahil meron din talagang evolution, may nagbabago rin sa sitwasyon na hinaharap natin dito sa South China Sea, sa gitna ng mga pangyayari, sa Taiwan, sa North Korea, lahat ito mga ano na medyo umiinit ang sitwasyon dito sa atin.
Filipino and American troops will conclude on Friday their three-week joint military drills in the Philippines 2 days before President Marcos Jr. departs for Washington.
A retired justice of the Philippine Supreme Court urges the Marcos Jr. administration to begin oil exploration activities in the Reed Bank. Antonio Carpio says this would ensure the Philippines will not lose any Reed Bank oil deposits to China. Carpio says Chinese control of possible oil resources there would result in higher power rates on the main Philippine island of Luzon. He says Manila's Enhanced Defense Cooperation Agreement with Washington plays a role in a possible oil exploration in the Reed Bank.
Our most pressing problem with China now is how to get the gas in Reed Bank because Malampaya is running out of gas. the formula is to send our survey ship to reach back, a drilling ship accompanied by the Navy, and have joint patrols with the U.S. in the same area. That's really the solution. How does EDCA come here? Well, EDCA is an implementation of the Mutual Defense Treaty. The Supreme Court said that it implements the Mutual Defense Treaty because the U.S. would be prepositioning their military equipment, weapons in warehouses in Philippine bases. And this will now be a message to China that we are ready to protect our survey ships, our drilling platforms in Reed Bank with the cooperation of the U.S. And this is all about this hullabaloo about EDCA is really about Reed Bank, how to get the gas in Reed Bank.
Beijing says it respects the sovereign status of former Soviet states. A Chinese Foreign Ministry spokesperson made the clarification after controversial remarks by Beijing's ambassador to Paris. The envoy earlier told a television interview that there is no international agreement that would effectively establish the status of former Soviet states as sovereign countries. His remarks prompted European countries to demand a clarification from Beijing. They warned the diplomat's comments could undermine China's efforts to mediate a peace deal between Russia and Ukraine.
Australia will make its biggest defense overhaul since World War II in response to China's military buildup and its threats to regional security. A government commission review earlier acknowledged that the United States is no longer the unipolar leader of the Indo-Pacific. It urged Canberra to implement measures that would help avoid a major conflict within the region. The review noted that Australia should prioritize its long-range strike capabilities to deter enemies before they reach the country's shores. It also recommended an increase in government funding for defense and manufacture munitions domestically. Prime Minister Anthony Albanese says the review would aid Australia in becoming more self-reliant and secure.
This represents a document for today and tomorrow. It is the most significant work that's been done since the Second World War, looking in a comprehensive way at what is needed. It demonstrates that in a world where challenges to our national security are always evolving, we cannot fall back on old assumptions. We must build and strengthen our security by seeking to shape the future rather than waiting for the future to shape us.
South Korean President Yoon Suk-yeol departs for the United States for a summit with President Biden. He's making the trip as he grapples for countermeasures to North Korea's evolving nuclear and missile threats. It is the first state visit to the U.S. by a South Korean leader in 12 years and will mark the 70th anniversary of the two countries' alliance. The two leaders are expected to explore ways to improve joint responses to deter North Korea, which has ramped up its weapons development. Philippine economic managers bear an elevated inflation forecast amid rising commodity prices. But as Jackie Pascual tells us, the higher consumer outlook is not expected to slow economic growth.
Expect more pain for consumers this year. The Philippine Development Budget Coordination Committee has raised the average inflation assumption for 2023 to 5 to 7% from the initial target range of 2.5 to 4.5%.
Given the persisting high prices of food, energy, and transport costs, nevertheless, the government, through the Interagency Committee on Inflation and Market Outlook, is committed to pursuing an all-of-government approach to continuously implement immediate and medium-term strategies to alleviate inflation.
The DBCC, however, does not expect elevated inflation to slow growth, as it maintained its GDP growth assumption for 2023 at between 6 and 7%.
The main sources of our growth have been domestic, no? Whether you look at it from the demand side, that's consumption and investment, and the supply side, you see those are services.
Meanwhile, additional tax measures are expected to boost government revenues to about 3.73 trillion pesos this year.
We are thinking of additional revenue measures and excise tax. This is an additional tax on sweetened beverages. And then there's a motor vehicles, road users tax. Again, this is not a new tax. And there's a mining fiscal regime tax.
One analyst, however, is concerned about the effect of the higher inflation assumption on interest rates.
This will definitely influence policy moving forward. Inflation can still continue to be riskier moving forward. Also, considering that there's, you know, climate change impact is becoming more and more apparent. And so the increase in prices in rice and sugar that's brought about by drought, not just seasonal factors. And so it could be a more of an ongoing concern, really, a more normalized concern.
The private sector is also wary of inflation, but they mostly remain optimistic.
For 2023, we expect a slowdown as a result of higher interest rates and the inflationary pressures that we have experienced since last year. But we don't expect a recession similar to other countries in the developed economy.
The Philippine government will report first quarter GDP growth on May 11th. Jackie Pascual, ABS-CBN News.
Tributes continue to pour in for the late esteemed businessman and Lopez clan patriarch Oscar Lopez, who died Saturday at the age of 93. His friends and employees at the conglomerate he built recall how he gave meaning to their work. RG Cruz has that story.
Farley Quezon spent over two decades as a paralegal in First Philippine Holdings, but more than working alongside the late Lopez Group patriarch Oscar Moreno Lopez, Quezon remembers how the man, fondly known as OML, took care of his people like they were his family, even outside the office.
Inaalaw niya kami na maging yung dreams namin e ma-pursue kahit na sa iba't ibang pagkakataon, sa iba't ibang bagay. And si OML, bilang mahilig ako sa music, and he is also mahilig din po siya sa music, na nagkataon na itinayo niya yung Orchestra of the Filipino Youth. And one time, nung nag-83rd birthday siya, inalaw ako, I had the opportunity to sing for him sa birthday niya. At yung dream ko na makakanta with the accompaniment of the orchestra, natupad dahil kay OML.
Ana Hirochi, for her part, is thankful about how OML made their work meaningful, not just to them on a personal level, but to the country.
Always be grateful to him for giving us companies that contribute to nation building and to uplifting lives of others, because as an employee, that gives us very meaningful work, work that aligns with our values and our purpose.
Former Speaker Sonny Belmonte fondly recalls his friendship with OML outside politics. In their younger years, Belmonte, then a journalist, took in OML as he covered the streets of Manila, back when OML had just graduated from Harvard.
I was still maybe 18, 19 when Oscar graduated from Harvard. You know? He asked me, "Oy, Sonny, kanya, can you show me around the realities of Manila?" Manila pinag-usapan namin noon eh. Sabi ko, "Yeah, sige. Since I'm a police reporter, why don't you join me for a while?" So for several days, he was with me in Manila Cron in the police beat, no? Walking around, going around, and he saw the other aspects of life in the metropolitan area.
Senator Lauren Lugarda lauds OML's work on the environment and hopes this legacy will live on.
Man who cared about nature and the environment long before many mm-hmm. people did, and he just did not care for it, but also did what he could to help enhance the life we live.
OML's wake continues in Rockwell with daily Novena Masses at 6 p.m. The funeral mass is scheduled on April 26. RG Cruz, ABS-CBN News.
Our final word tonight is a quote from Madame de Staël. We understand death only after it has placed its hands on someone we love.
And that is The World Tonight, the 24th of April, 2023. I'm Pia Gutierrez.
I'm Tony Velasquez from the Philippines. Thank you. Mabuhay!